Ladies and gentlemen, this brings me to the core of the subject for which we have all gathered here today. Achieving the second economic miracle and Vision 2030. As Prime Minister, I am not here to make promises. I am here to say to the nation that the second economic miracle is well within our reach. I want my whole cabinet to team up with you, the private sector, the public service, and the population at large to confidentially embrace and own our economic agenda to achieve the second economic miracle we all dream of. My aim today is to motivate you so that together we put Mauritius into the league of high income economies. I'm very clear in my mind. The economy has to be at the service of the population. Our focus has to be centered on the people of Mauritius. I have, therefore, identified four key focus areas that will personally drive and monitor to ensure our economic well-being. In addition to a series of measures my government has taken to redress the economy since we assumed office. These four key focus areas are: 1, addressing unemployment; 2, alleviating, if not eradicating, poverty; 3, opening up our country and new access policies; and 4, sustainable development and innovation. There is no magic solution to addressing the issues of unemployment and poverty. Our only recourse is to build on our existing economic setup and create new opportunities to ignite growth across all our economic sectors. The benefit of the ensuing economic buoyancy can only boil down to our people. This, no doubt, requires both the consolidation of our existing sectors of activities as well as the development of new economic avenues. While a considerable extent of this strategy will be driven by the government, we will certainly rely on the close collaboration of the private sector operators in making the necessary investments. It is exactly in this bid that I am constantly pushing to review growth strategies for all our sectors of economic activities to attract more investment. And one thing is of paramount importance: we inevitably need a more open and robust air access policy and takes into account both the national interests and economic growth. I'm focusing on this issue at the moment, and important decisions will follow. I'm also giving a new dimension to our economic diplomacy through our main diplomatic missions in order to maximize on global opportunities for our country. Ladies and gentlemen, the economic model we have chosen for the development of our country will be centered on a number of core areas to fundamentally transform the economy. These include, first, a revamped and dynamic manufacturing base with clearly identified focus on promoting high-end, precision-driven, and technology-enabled manufacturing in the country. Few countries in the world can progress without a sustainable manufacturing base. Manufacturing today accounts for about 18% of our economy, and we aim to increase its share significantly to 25% within the next 3 years. Here, we have already provided the necessary support mechanisms to attract more players in high precision engineering, food processing, pharmaceutical products, jewelry, and watchmaking, light manufacturing, and other fast-moving consumer goods, amongst others. Secondly, we are leveraging on one of our largest asset base, which is our exclusive maritime economic zone. To develop our ocean industry, I see extensive possibilities in this field. Our fishing industry is being given its due and importance in this regard. We are already negotiating with major international fishing companies for the setting up of fishing and seafood processing facilities locally. We are also in discussion with fishing companies and ports authorities for the development of fishing ports in the country to transform Mauritius into a major regional fishing center. Moreover, a National Ocean Council has been set up to drive and implement projects as regards the ocean economy. Mauritius actually has the potential to develop as a major port for the region. As our manufacturing industry grows through our market access to COMESA and SADC countries, our port will have to handle much higher cargo traffic. But what is most interesting is the fact that Africa is fast catching the world's attention in terms of both investments and trade. And we are blessed with a natural geographic advantage by being an African country at the doorstep of the continent. Ladies and gentlemen, there are about 30,000 ships passing by Mauritius annually, out of which about 3,000 call at Port Louis. We are actively working to attract a substantial number of these vessels for bunkering and other related services in order to transform Port Louis into a leading regional petroleum hub. Earlier this year in the budget, we announced our plans to more than double the size of our port. Taking cognizance of the Port Master Plan, I see Port Louis being developed as a modern port with state-of-the-art facilities. This will also allow us to benefit from a number of multiplier benefits and help generate many more jobs. With a buoyant port comes the need for a whole range of support services, including freight companies and logistics service providers, just to mention but a few. The private sector will be encouraged to permanently recruit these trainees. I am committed to see that job creation is being delivered as forecast. Each and every stakeholder will have to play his part of the game. My government will see to it that there is no impediment to investment and job creation. I want to assure investors that I will personally see to it that permits, licenses, and related authorizations are delivered with utmost priority. We shall unlock issues that stand as stumbling blocks for the investments. Unjustified delays will not be tolerated and sanctions will be taken. That is the reason behind my decision to set up a high-powered committee under my chairmanship to closely monitor project facilitation and implementation. The committee will meet as often as needed to further enhance business facilitation and deliver on our investment targets. If we need to burn the midnight oil to attain our objectives, we are prepared to go that far. Ladies and gentlemen, my government remains committed to adopting a responsible and environmentally sustainable policy regarding energy production, waste management, and physical infrastructural development. The public sector investment program for the next 5 years amounts to some 75 billion rupees. These heavy investments in the water sector, electricity, waste management, wastewater management, roads, port, airport, and communication, amongst others, have already been announced and are being accelerated. Next year, in July at latest, works under the road decongestion program will be kick-started. we will be investing $15 billion over the next 5 years to address the road congestion problem that cannot and should not continue to cost millions to the economy. Clearly, Mauritius will become a vast chantier for infrastructural modernization that will put the country further on the path leading to a higher level of development. Ladies and gentlemen, the success in delivering on our economic agenda will largely depend on our mindset and the determination to make things happen. Here, I wish to address civil servants and staff of public sector institutions. I expect you to be active drivers in the nation-building process. I want a new mindset that focuses on national targets rather than on routine administrative jobs only. I want civil servants to act like passionate facilitators for achievements to happen. I want the public service to be efficient and creative because I have relieved you from the Jurassic clause that held you immobile under the previous regime. I also have a message for the captains of the private sector. There should be a mindset that favors constructive dialogue and a partnership stance with my government. I'm confident that with the concerted effort of one and all, we shall achieve it. Let me reassure the nation that I am resolute in my commitment to lead the new socio-economic transformation process. I have no doubt at all that during the coming years, till the end of my government's mandate, we would have brought meaningful change and significant achievements. But I want also to leave as my legacy to future generations a strategic forward planning document for continued progress of our country. That would be Vision 2030. A modern Mauritius needs a socially inclusive model of development, geared by intellectual capital, knowledge, and skills. We must collectively overcome our common challenges. This is why I value private sector involvement and active participation in the working committees. This convergence will help us draw clear and coherent strategies to achieve nationally benefiting goals. In the past, Mauritians have demonstrated their sense of patriotism and have given proof of their debouillages. We know how to work together and to achieve beyond expectations, especially if elected political leaders set the example. I want to set the example and exhort others to follow suit. Once again, let us focus on priorities on which the destiny of our country depends. Let's strive to give our children, our youth, and our elders the quality of life that will result from a concerted national effort under my leadership. William Shakespeare rightly said, I quote, "It is not in the stars to hold our destiny, but in ourselves." Indeed, the destiny of our country is in our own hands. Ladies and gentlemen, those who dare succeed, those who lament are losers. As a nation, we need to be ambitious. We need to believe in ourselves. Together, we delivered the first economic miracle against all odds. And I have no doubt that we will do it yet again, together.